thank you for the welcome on my behalf. You guys are in for a little surprise because I found out on Shabbat that this part of my microphone was rubbing up against my cheek, and usually I'm all over the place. I am over there, turning around, moving around, and I wasn't able to do it as much as I wanted to, but we fixed the microphone, and so we're going to get some exercise in, and I'm not talking about me, I'm talking about you guys. So get ready, because you guys are going to have some exercise. Wanted to give a praise report. We're having a heat wave in Colorado. Right now it is 25 degrees and raining in Fruta. But by Wednesday, or by Shabbat, we're supposed to get up to 47. So there you go. There should be snow probably on Wednesday. It's, what is it? On Wednesday it should be a high of 44, a low of 18. So there you go. Praise God. This is what we get to go back to. And yeah, if any of you guys want to come with us, you certainly are more than welcome. It is currently 34, wind 6 miles an hour from the west, and the dew point is 26 degrees. That's incredible. So, all right, enough with the tomfoolery. How many of you guys here have ever had a chance to speak publicly about the Lord, or you knew you had an appointment coming up with someone to talk about the Lord? How many of you guys? How many of you guys got to the point where you had no clue what you were going to say? That's almost amazing, because almost every hand that was raised here, the first part, raised their hand on the second part as well. And I like to say that there are times when I get up to preach, and I have no clue what the Holy Spirit is going to say. And that is a very, very humbling thing. It is incredibly humbling. And as I was getting ready for this teaching, Yahweh said, I'm going to get you into Romans chapter 7. And the end of Romans chapter 7, I have great confidence in what Yahweh is going to do, and I pray that it's going to be a blessing to you guys as well. But in my PowerPoint, I also included some stuff from the middle of Romans chapter 7, because I had this really great idea of what I was going to try and share it. I don't remember what that is. I don't remember what I was going to teach from the beginning of Romans chapter 7. And here I am in front of 80 people or so, and I'm looking at you, and I'm wondering, what am I going to say? I really don't know. And I was reminded of Luke chapter 12, verses 11 and 12, where Yeshua says, when they bring you before the synagogues and the rulers and the authorities, do not worry about how or what you are to speak in your defense or what you are to say, for the Holy Spirit will teach you in that very hour what you ought to say. So here we are in that very hour. Here I am, not knowing what I ought to say. I'm looking at you as the rulers and authorities. But we're going to have just a good time. We're going to share some things. How many of you guys remember on Shabbat the three different sources of offenses that we talked about? What was the first one? From ourselves, the flesh. What was the second one? What was that? Outside the church, the world. And the third one was? Within the church. Today we're going to talk about some of the offenses that we end up taking on our own. So there are a lot of people, and I'm sure it's not this way here, but it is this way in Colorado, where we struggle with knowing who we are and the victory that God can give us in our life. How many of you guys here ever struggle with whether or not Yahweh sees you as capable and that you've got things going on, you kind of have you got life figured out. You got scripture figured out. Does anyone here ever struggle with that? Knowing who you are and who God wanted you to be? We all struggle with that. How many of you guys have an area of sin or struggle in your life that seems to always be there? Okay, three people. The rest of you have it going on. You guys are perfect. You're ready for Yeshua to come back because, you know, hey, God, I've got it. I've got it. You can take me and work with everyone else. We all have struggles. Everyone. Mine can be laziness. I can be a very lazy person at some time. I really love sugar. Little Debbie has a snack for you. Little Debbie has a lot of snacks for me. And I, unfortunately, take too much advantage of that. But we all have struggles. And for most of us, at least for me, when we get to that point where we fail, and I touched on this on Shabbat, when we fail, we start to keep a record of how many times we have failed in that particular area. And you say, I've done that. I've done it before. I've done it before. And we start keeping track of, you know, out of 100 times, I failed in that particular area. I ate the Twinkie 100 times. But what Yahweh has taught me over the last couple of years is that if you have victory in that one particular area once, that is something to rejoice in. And then the next day, if you have victory over it twice, that is something to rejoice in. And I know people who have struggled with alcoholism, drug addiction, things like that, pornography. And they get down on themselves because they struggle and struggle and struggle. But if there is a day that they go without the alcohol, without the drugs, without looking at stuff on the internet, that's a day to praise God. That is a day to be thankful and to not look at the other days that you have failed, but to be able to say, praise God, you have allowed me to have victory over this day. And it's those things that we need to hold on to. It's those things that we need to hold on to. It's our memorial stones. Have you guys ever studied memorial stones before? And how those are the things that are meant to remind Israel of how faithful God has been. And there's so many times where Yahweh will tell Israel to set up a pile of stones. And the reason why is that so when your children come back here, and they say, what is this for? And then you can recount all the words that Yahweh has, all the works that Yahweh has done. It's very similar to Moses' burning bush experience. There was a bush that was burning, and it never, ever stopped. It's continually burning, which is what those memorial stones do for us. In our mind, there are those burning bushes that never are consumed, that are always in our memory, that we are reminded of how wonderful Yahweh is and how he has worked in our life in mighty ways. And it's those things that he wants us to remember. He wants us to remember that one day that we went without the alcohol, without gossiping. Ooh. Who here likes to gossip? Who here does gossip? Yes, a couple of you. No one else is raising their hand because you want to talk about that person later. They gossip. They struggle with that. Did you see them? They didn't raise their hand. Oh. That's gossip, ladies and gentlemen. That day that you go without that particular sin, hold on to that. Hold on to just that one day. And then the next day, try it again. And if you fail, what do you have to hold on to? The day before that you struggled. And that day becomes a memorial stone. And then you tell yourself, I loved that day. That was a great day. And we're going to go back to that day. That is the offense that we sometimes give ourselves, is that we hold on to that record of wrong, and that becomes our identity in a lot of ways. I'm the person that struggles with this. I'm not the redeemed creature of Yahweh anymore. I'm that carnal, fleshly person. Which, while true, should remind us that Yahweh is transforming us day by day. So I want to get into Romans chapter 7. So if you guys have your Bible, please open that. If you're having trouble figuring out where Romans chapter 7 is, it's on page 1459. It's right before Romans chapter 8. Sorry, could I maybe get the microphone down just a little bit? How about that? Oh, good, now I can yell. Now I can walk around without you guys hearing me breathe because I'm so not in shape that just by going over here, I get a little bit winded and it's like, which is weird because I'm from Colorado and I should have a whole lot more air here. Spiritual schizophrenia. Spiritual schizophrenia is something that we all struggle with. And spiritual schizophrenia is basically knowing that there are two different identities living in you at any given time. And it can go back and forth, go back and forth, back and forth. When you're here at Shabbat, have you noticed on Shabbat you guys are perfect? Seriously, how many of you guys actively sin on Shabbat? Not many. It is very, very easy to not sin on Shabbat, right? Because you come in here, it's like, yeah, got my nice clothes on, gonna sing some worship, gonna dance, that's pretty cool, sitting next to this person, and they know that I need to like have my life all in order and everything. So we're gonna put on the face, and we're gonna have baked potatoes afterwards. We're gonna have baked potatoes. That was phenomenal. I saw someone, one of the ladies, was like rubbing a block of butter on like this hot pan, and then she threw like the whole thing of butter on my potato. And I was like, I love you, woman. I don't know who you are. Please move back to Fruta. Please don't let my wife see what you're doing. And then the next table over was this bowl, this crock pot of melted nacho cheese. It was fantastic. And I'm thinking, okay, well, that's the cheese. We're just going to glob that thing on there. And then right after that, there was shredded cheese. And then we put chili on it. That was almost a sin of gluttony, wasn't it? Did anyone else walk away saying, boy, I'm kind of gluttonous, and I'm not going to eat dinner tonight because I am done. And then there was like the brownies afterwards. Oh, my. The brownies. There was a strawberry on top of them, thereby making them healthy. That is the one thing that you rejoice in. Yes, I ate the brownie. Yes, I ate the 1 pound of nacho cheese, but there was a strawberry. Wonderful thing. I say that because on Shabbat, it is very easy. When you come here tonight, how many of you have sinned since you walked in here? No one. No one here has sinned since they walked in here. No one dares raise their hand. Because it is easy to not sin while you're here, right? Now, how many of you think it's more likely that you will sin at 10 o'clock tonight when you get home? Because you're not amongst the body of believers. Let me say this right up front. A lot of the questions I'm asking are rhetorical. So don't necessarily feel like you have to raise your hand. Because what you guys don't know is the people up there, there are three people up there. There's one PowerPoint thing. You know what the other two are doing? They're keeping score. Did you know that? No one knows that. If you ever wondered why there's so many people up there, they all have different jobs. One of them is to keep score. So you are being judged right now by the body. Isn't that comforting? That is a wonderful thing. So you don't need to raise your hand when I go over these questions. It's okay. The schizophrenia comes in when we realize that you are living by the Spirit. You are a redeemed, righteous creation right now. You have a desire to fellowship with the body. You have the desire to worship, to dance, as goofy as that may be. I was dancing right over here, and I did this whole thing going back. And my son, he loves to just dance right here. And then has the audacity to say, ow, ow, and then like hit me. Or what do you think he also wanted to do? Kick me in the shin. Look at you guys. You might just think about that going on. That's awesome. But you come here and you want to dance and it's great and you love it. And then you hear teaching from this weird goober guy and it's wonderful. And then you go home and you have an argument with your spouse. Oh, don't raise your hand, but you know it might be coming. Have you ever come here or on Shabbat and you'd had a big argument with your spouse and then you don't raise your hand? You're 12. I mean, the whole betrothal thing is getting younger and younger these days. Seriously. I mean, we wait until at least 15 years old. 12? 11? Whew. My goodness. other than him, have you guys ever been in an argument with your spouse right before you come here, and then on Shabbat or Torah study, you're just kind of hanging out next to each other, and you got your arm around one another, you're praising God, and everything's wonderful, and then you go home, and it's... We all do that. That, in the course of 3 hours, is spiritual schizophrenia. One way or the other, you could go backwards and forwards. And it is terrible. It's depressing because you know who you should be and who you are. When we are a finite, carnal, imperfect, sinful creation trying to dwell with a perfect and holy and infinite God, we will always pale in comparison. And we will always go back and forth. What we tend to do is I say that and we go back and forth, and we tend to think about all the ways that we screwed up and the ways that we're in our flesh, right? When I talk about going back and forth, are you kind of tempted to think more on the sinful carnal side, yeah? But it's also just as true that you can say, but there's also the redeemed person being made more and more into the likeness of Yeshua. It's not a matter of positive thinking. It's a matter of knowing who Yahweh created you to be, why he created you to be that way, and what he wants to do with you. So Romans chapter 7, this is where I had a really great idea, and I don't remember what it was. But let's start in Romans verse 7, and let's see what happens. All right? I'm just as excited and nervous as all of you guys. I've been up here so far, and you're wondering, where is he going with this? I am just right up there with you. Where am I going to go with this? I actually kind of have an idea now. Verse 7. What shall we say then? Is the law sin? May it never be. On the contrary, I would not have come to know sin except through the law. For I would not have known about coveting if the law had not said, you shall not covet. But sin, taking opportunity through the commandment, produced in me coveting of every kind, for apart from the law is sin, or from apart from the law, sin is dead. Moving on, I was once alive apart from the law, but when the commandment came, sin became alive and I died. And this commandment, which was to result in life, proved to result in death for me. For sin, taking an opportunity through the commandment, deceived me and through it killed me. So then, the law is holy, and the commandment is holy and righteous and good. Therefore, did that which is good become a cause of death for me? May it never be. Rather, it was sin in order that it might be shown to be sin by affecting my death through that which is good, so that through the commandment, sin would become utterly sinful. Now, that's kind of confusing, yeah? Have you ever had conversations with people that want to debate you and come against Torah? This is one of the big chapters they will use. They'll also use the entire book of Galatians. Those are the two big ones. And those are confusing. The biggest thing that I can tell you to take away from that is context is key. To know who Paul is talking about. He is talking about those who are using the Torah, the law, for means of salvation or right standing before God, or what you might say justification. If I gave you a car and you decided to drive off the mountain to see if it would fly, probably not going to work, right? Does that mean the car was bad? No. It is not doing what it was intended to do. That is the exact same thing through the law, through the Torah. It cannot save. It was never meant to save. It was meant to be a reflection of our need for a Messiah and to be saved. So people will come to you and say, well, the law can't save. And if you're going to keep some of it, you got to keep all of it. And if you break one commandment, you've broken them all, and therefore you are under the law. How many people here have been told you're under the law? And then if you ask them, what do you mean by under the law, they will skip that answer because they can't really define what under means. Galatians and Romans 7, Paul is talking to the people that are trying to use it for salvation, and that cannot happen. It is meant to show you how to live in the presence of a holy and perfect God. The reason why I say this is because it is a very confusing chapter. Now, if you guys have ever sat down, how many of you guys started reading the Torah portion yesterday or today? Okay? You're ready to get in there. You're ready to go through all three chapters. Here we go. Exodus, we're going to get, is it Jethro now that we're into? Starting Friday. My father-in-law. Always a tough portion for me. Because my father-in-law is Pastor Curtis. So this is the week that I am not allowed to say anything. I cannot teach my father-in-law. I have to sit there and let him teach me and give me counsel. Have you ever realized there are a couple Torah portions that you always end up reading or teaching on? Do you know that that's not by accident? Numbers 30 is one of my big ones, the laws of vows and oaths. If I say Numbers 30, a whole lot of you are not sure. It's, you know, if the bride says something and then husband hears it and he nullifies it, then it's no longer void, and then the daughter and the father thing. Always end up on that because that's one of the Torah portions Yahweh gave me. And Jethro kind of tends to be that way. And if you find yourself with various Torah portions that you're always kind of drawn to or that you end up teaching in studies with your family or in small groups or whatever it might be, Yahweh wants to deal with you in a mighty way in that. So for us, we're ready to read the Torah. Okay, yesterday, you sit down with the family, breakfast, right after Shabbat. You're excited. New week, gonna get in the Word. Had a rough week. Didn't really read the Torah portion at all, but this week, by golly, it will be different. We are going to read the Torah portion one chapter at a time before our kids, and it will be great. Or maybe you're really bold, and maybe you're really just got the gusto, and we're gonna read the whole thing. Right here, Sunday morning, gonna be great. Here we go, kids. And then Tuesday, we're gonna do the half Torah, because we're really spiritual. Thursday, Brit Hadashah. We're going to hit the New Testament, and we're going to see how everything is ready to go. How many of you guys have gotten, like, through five verses, and you're just completely lost? Yeah, and then you're discouraged, and you're not ready to go. Romans chapter 7. The reason why I included this is because I don't know. Serious. You guys might remember on Shabbat, I mentioned that there are a couple things that I don't teach on because I don't know. Revelation, I don't teach on. I don't know it. Daniel, all that stuff, I don't teach on it. I don't know. Creation, Genesis 1 through 7, I don't really teach on it because I don't know. If I get the Torah portion, Bereshith, hey, Yahweh created in 7 days, let's get into the other stuff. Not because creation is not worthy of being studied, but because that's not on my heart. I trust Yahweh. I know that He created. I know that He created in order. I know that He is the one that created. I know that. I'm going to leave all the debating and the scientific stuff for other people. That is not my heart. I'm going to let other people. I'm going to let my father-in-law do that. When you are reading and you get into Romans chapter 7, you might get stuck on the beginning parts here. You might get stuck through the end of verse 13. And it is really a struggle. This is where I was at about 2 hours ago, is I had a thought a few days ago, a week ago. I was ready to teach on verses 7 through 13. I had great stuff. You guys should have been with me at home. Oh, it was wonderful. I wish I had recorded the CD. It would have been wonderful just sitting at home. Ooh, Yahweh, good. Oh, gosh, that's great. Bet Tehila will love that. And then I'm looking at my notes earlier today, and I can't remember any of it. That is so depressing. It is so discouraging. But Yahweh was reminding me of the last several verses about the whole the spiritual schizophrenia thing and how I get caught up in the things that I don't remember and the things I don't know, instead of getting to the stuff that I do know. Have you ever wondered why Yahweh has caused you to forget certain things? Because He doesn't want you to say it. And you get in front and you're ready to tell someone, you're ready to lay the smack down, you are going to put them in their place. You're going to tell them how the Torah is active, why the Torah is active, and how it fits with the Gospels. Yeah? You ever been in that way? You are ready to go. You got the notes and stuff. You got Romans Road. You got all that stuff ready to go. And then you forget about it. But you share other stuff, which in turn is the stuff that Yahweh wanted you to share so that you didn't get caught up in everything else. And that's exactly where I was with Romans 7. So this is where we're going to have some fun, all of us. Your chair nice and comfy? These are great chairs, aren't they? They really are. I mean, they're not like the little metal folding chairs. Really comfortable. Glad you're sitting in them? Because you're not going to be sitting in them for much longer. How many of you guys just feel like you're all ready to move and you guys have been dancing, you're ready to go? You're not done yet. Because we are going to do a little physical application of what's going on here. And I can tell you now, there's going to be a little bit of chaos. Because Yahweh wants us to be a little bit chaotic tonight. You guys okay with that? Too bad, because I'm going to do it anyway. Let's get into Romans 7, all right? We're going to start in verse 14. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am of flesh, sold into bondage to sin. This is going to be, you guys know this, these verses, the do-dos, the don't-dos? For I do what I don't want to do, and I don't do what I want to do. Yeah. So I want you all to get up. I'm serious. Get up. We are doing this, folks. We are getting up. I want you guys to all come forward. Oh, boy. I'm serious. Get up. Come up here. Get in the middle. Get in a group. Get in a line. Please, feel free to get up on the stage, okay? If you feel like you're not capable of physically getting up here and walking, because I'm going to have you guys walk back and forth. If you feel like you're not able to walk back and forth in the midst of a group, that is okay. There are people leaving. So, always discouraging. Always discouraging. So what we're going to do is we are going to read through these verses one section at a time. If you guys want to get up here, you might want to join me up here because we are going to be, have you guys ever gotten a chance to be up here? This is really nice. This is. Way to go, Beit, Tehila. You guys are nice. So we are going to read through these things. And camera guys, I'm sorry. You're on your own. You figure out what you want to do up here. So we're going to go through these things. You guys are all on camera. You guys are part of this message. Praise God. I am going to read a section at a time. Now, let's say this is about the redeemed, holy, transformed, saved by Yeshua side, okay? This is the Spirit. This is the Spirit. Sorry, folks, you guys chose wrong. It's okay. This is the carnal, sinful, fleshly side, okay? Sorry, I don't know what to tell you. I am going to read a point here, and you guys have to decide which side this verse is talking about, okay? It's going to either be about the holy, righteous, redeemed you, or the sinful, carnal, falling flat on your face you, okay? Does that kind of make sense? And you're going to walk back and forth. If you don't know what it's talking about, or you're having trouble figuring out, that's okay. You guys ready? Sure. We have one sure. Everyone's like, this is just going to be a disaster. It very well could be a disaster. Let's see what happens. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am of flesh, sold into bondage to sin. What is this verse talking about? Ready, set, go. You have to actually move. You actually have to move. Don't be afraid to go against the grain. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am of flesh, sold into bondage to sin. You're supposed to be over here. Because it is talking about you in your flesh nature, right? This is not the redeemed side. This is recognizing that Paul is talking about the flesh. Let's go on. It already put up there, the arrow. Oh, well. For what I am doing, I do not understand. It's this side. You don't understand. You don't understand the fleshly things that you're doing. You guys understand? It's a little confusing. Just a little bit. That's okay. Okay. For I am not practicing what I would like to. Don't be afraid to go against the grain, for I am not practicing what I would like to. That side. You know what you're supposed to do, but you're not practicing it. You're acting according to the flesh. These people are optimistic. They're optimistic. Don't judge. Don't judge. For I am not practicing what I would like to do. But I am doing the very thing I hate. You guys are right. You were over here. I apologize. The arrows are off. But you guys got it. But I am doing the very thing I hate. This is the fleshly side of you. Again, you're doing the very thing you hate. But if I do the very thing I do not want to do, don't look at the arrows because they're confusing and they're out of order. But if I do the very thing I do not want to do, right, you guys are right here. I agree with the law, confessing that the law is good. Yes, son, again. Very good. So now, no longer am I the one doing it, but sin which dwells in me. No longer am I the one doing it, but sin which dwells in me. Is that a redeemed person talking, or is that someone in their flesh talking? Someone who is acting in the flesh, or someone who is acting redeemed? This is over here. This is you guys, not acting the way that you're supposed to do. These two ladies, hey, optimistic, very nice. Cup overfloweth half full. Praise God. Okay, verse 18. For I know that nothing good dwells in me that is in my flesh. Hurry up. Come on. You guys should have been over there faster. This one's easy. Okay? That is in my flesh. I had the arrows wrong, didn't I? For I know that nothing good dwells in me that is in my flesh. For the willing is present in me. The willing is present in me. The willing is present. Watch out. Don't hit me. The willing is present in me. Or are you, you're willing to do what is right? This is not what you guys signed up for, was it? Hey, how are you? Good to see you over there. But the doing of the good is not. You want to do the good, but it is not there. I really apologize. The arrows are off, but you guys are getting the idea here. You guys are getting the idea. The doing of the good is not. The doing that you want to do is not what you are doing. For the good that I want... The good that I want, no, you are not being graded. If so, I'm going to fail because this is chaos. This is getting obnoxious. For the good that I want, I do not do. But I practice the very evil that I do not want. There you go. I practice the very evil that I do not want. You guys are right. You guys are right. But if I'm doing the very thing I do not want, this is do not want. If I'm doing the very thing I do not want, I am no longer the one doing it. You're no longer the one doing the thing you don't want to do. Could go either way. I could go either way. But sin which dwells in me. But sin which dwells in me. Very good. Very good. Let's go on just a little bit longer. I find then that the principle that evil is present in me. Very good. The one who wants to do good. Maybe. I can't remember what's next, honestly. My arrows are off. The one who wants to do good. For I joyfully concur with the law of God in the inner man. I joyfully concur with the law of God in the inner man. Usually joyfully means a good thing. Joyfully incur with the law of God in the inner man. Joyfully concur with the law of God in the inner man. Joyfully concur.
I thought that was the good side. That's the bad side.
Come on, we're all lemmings over here. We're all jumping over the edge together. Either we're all right or we're all wrong. But I see a different law in the members of my body, waging war against the law of my mind. But I see a different law in the members of my body, waging war against the law of my mind. You could, but therefore you would be lukewarm, and then Yahweh would spit you out of his mouth. There you go. I see a different law in the members of my body, waging war against the law of my mind, and making me a prisoner of the law of sin, which is in my members. Making me a prisoner of the law of sin, which is in my members. Very good. Verses 24 through 25. Thanks be to God through Yeshua HaMashiach, our Lord. Everyone pretty confident you're on the right side? You are wrong. You are wrong. This verse has nothing to do with you. It has absolutely nothing to do with you, does it? It's an up. It's an up. It has nothing. You guys are so vain. You probably think this song is about you. That's the irony. It is about you. You. Thanks be to Yahweh through Yeshua HaMashiach, our Lord. So then on the one hand, I find myself with my mind am serving the law of God. So then on the one hand, I myself with my mind am serving the law of God. But on the other, with my flesh, the law of sin. Even my own children are saying, you're confusing me, Daddy. You're confusing me. Daddy's confusing himself. It's okay. But on the other, with my flesh, the law of sin. Okay, you guys can go ahead and sit down. Go ahead. Good job. Good job. All right. Was that confusing for anyone here? It's confusing, wasn't it? Back and forth. Back and forth. Don't know which side to be on. Can't remember which side was good, which side was bad. Did you guys have trouble figuring out which side was the good side and which side was the bad side? And which concept meant good or bad? Some of you I heard saying, well, what's the rest of the verse? Because there's a big and or but or though in there. And you're waiting for the next thing, right? It's confusing. So is your life. At any given moment, you could be on either side. You could be walking back and forth. Within minutes. We did that for what, 5-10 minutes? How many times did you go back and forth? Dozen? Over a 10-minute period, you went over about a dozen times. Now, we think of Paul, other than Yeshua, maybe Moses, Paul got it right, right? He knew what he was doing, pretty much. He knew what he was doing. If in the course of 11 verses or so, Paul is going back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, are we any different? Do we expect ourselves to be different? That's a standard we set, isn't it? You would like to think over a 10-minute period in your life, you know what you should be doing. But over the course of the last 10 minutes, you had no clue what you were doing. And frankly, neither did I at some point. This is meant to encourage you in the fact that life is not always easy. And we should be content, not content, but accepting of the thought, the idea is that we are going to go back and forth. Someone asked me on Shabbat, how do I know that Yahweh is still pleased with me and still doing something with me? My answer was, if you're still asking that question, he's still working on you. If you get to the point where you don't care, or you feel like the Spirit of God is no longer speaking to you, that's a bad place. Not going to get into the whole once saved, always saved thingamajigger. That's just messy and ugly, and boy, that's contentious. But if Yahweh is still speaking to you and you are still struggling with the do's and the don't do's, you are Yahweh's. And he is working on you. And he is refining you. He is absolutely refining you because you got tired and confused going from here over to here, over to here. That's because Yahweh is trying to draw out in you the things that please him and the things that do not. And that is wonderful. It talks about being tested through the fire or being pruned. This is something that we've been learning back at Bethlehem, is that a tree that is pruned is usually bearing fruit. A tree that is bearing fruit is often pruned, why? To bear more fruit. You might look at your life and you think, I'm doing this well. I am doing this well. It is good. Here we go. It is good. And then Yahweh says, you know what? We need to lop that sucker off right there. Ministry here. I don't know if it's been like this for you guys in the past. I know it's certainly been this way at Bethlehem. A ministry that you guys are doing here is bearing fruit. You got people invested in it, resources, time, gifts, anointings. And then all of a sudden, the ministry is meant to stop. Kind of a hard thing, isn't it? We were doing this with the prison ministry in Bethlehem. We were sending our Torah studies and some CDs out to prisoners who were actually in prison. We were up to like a couple hundred, I think, sending them out. People calling us. They wanted more CDs. They wanted us to come and minister. They wanted us to come into the prisons. They wanted us to teach this messianic thing. They started all congregating and having Bible studies there. They started talking to the chef saying, well, we eat kosher. We need better meals. If you ever find yourself in prison and you want to eat better, ask to eat kosher. You'll eat a lot better. People were starting to use that as an excuse. That's beside the point. There was fruit going on in that ministry. We got to a point where we had to condense our ministries in general to some degree, and that was one of the ones that went away. Anyone in here been getting the CDs or listening online to any of the things that we've done? Most of you guys had no idea Fruita even existed, so you're like, what? What's going on? We had to stop those for a season because we took a look at the resources that we had, and we realized we didn't have the resources to do it excellently, so we pruned. So that we can invest all the time, money, and resources necessary to do the ministry things that he had for us as excellently as possible. Now, praise God, he's starting to expand our ministries again because we're starting to bring some order into our ministry, which is awesome. But it was very hard to prune off things that were bearing fruit. It was very hard because you think, this is good. This is very good. But he did it so that we would be tested and refined and washed, remembering who he is and that he is the source of our life that we can give to others. When you struggle with Romans chapter 7, you're going back, and you're going forth, and it hurts, and it's confusing, and you resent the guy who's up here talking, or you resent Yahweh. Have you ever resented God for allowing you to go back and forth, back and forth? Don't have to raise your hand. Most of you probably have at some point in time. Why am I going through this, God? Why aren't you giving me clear direction? Why aren't you giving me instruction on what I need to be doing? You become resentful of God, but then maybe you get to the point where you start blaming yourself for going back and forth. I should know better. The good I want to do, I don't do. The law of God is good. The law of my flesh is bad. That's where the offenses come in. That's where the pessimism in your life comes in. That's where the vain imaginations come in. Have you guys talked much or know what the vain imaginations are? You're so vain, you probably think this song is about you, that whole thing. You get in your mind who you are, how you act, and then it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. Because you're confused, and then you get offended with yourself, and you start holding on to this false identity of who you are. And then you get to that point, Abba help us, where we stop hearing his voice. Where he either stops speaking to us or we just tune him out. Because we give up. We give up. We flat out give up. So I bring in this whole Romans 7 thing, and I have no idea where I'm at on time. We might get out of here early. We might be getting out of here late. Who knows? I've got nowhere to go. I'm not leaving till Friday. I'm staying at the house of people who have keys. You guys have keys? Hey! Life is confusing, and ministry to God is very confusing. A life serving Yahweh is very confusing, and it is extraordinarily hard. It is extraordinarily hard, and it is extraordinarily discouraging at times. Because you see who God is, you see what he has for you, and you see how you are failing so many times in achieving that. What he is calling us to do as believers, who are being transformed more and more into his likeness, day by day, we are being conformed more and more into his likeness, we start to realize that the pruning is a good thing, that the law is a good thing. This is something that I like to talk about, is that so many people look at the 613 laws, 614 if you add in the law of the circumcised heart thing, and they look at it as a burden. They look at it as all the ways that you are going to fail. If you've broken one sin, you've broken them all. I look at it as those are 613 ways to worship God in your daily life. Did you know? You did? Praise God. That there is a commandment on how to go to the bathroom.
Outside the camp.
Outside the camp with pails and shovels, and you got to go outside the camp. That is an opportunity for you to think about God in your daily life. There are no parts of your life that are absent from God or things that he doesn't care about. Now, whatever the spiritual lesson might be in going to the bathroom, I'll leave that up to you because that's just a weird thing and we're not going to go there. But do you understand what I'm saying? Is that God wants every part of our life. And he gives us 613 ways to honor him. 613 ways to say, God, how can I honor you today? How can I serve the God who is set apart and holy, who expects me to be set apart and holy? From the things we wear, the things we eat, the people we hang out with, the ways that we worship, the ways that we minister to others, the ways that we have conversations with people, the ways that we inspect houses to see if they're clean, the way that we inspect our garments to see if they're clean, the ways on bringing worship before God, the ways on going to war, all these different things, the ways that you plant fields and agriculture, the ways that you take care of animals, the way that you dig holes, the way that you construct your house. All of these things are activities that are instructed by God on how to do. Parapets, so that people don't fall. Cover up a hole. Do not take the mother and the baby. You know, all those things. Do not cook a young goat in its mother's milk. That's a weird one. That's one where people have gone way overboard. Way, way overboard. 613 ways to honor God. 613 ways to fail in your relationship with God. How do you view those? That is a question that you need to ask yourself on a daily basis. Is the law burdensome? May I call the law sinful? May it never be. Because it's showing you how to be made more and more into his likeness. And we should be thankful when we go through Leviticus 1 through 5, 1 through 6. Oh, some of the most boring chapters in all of the Word. It is. You guys are pretending to be spiritual if you say, no, they're exciting. No, it's not. Or all, how many of you guys, side note, completely random, when they get into the chapters of all the different offerings that Israel was supposed to be, all the shekels and all of the cows, how long do you read those chapters? Usually it's a, okay, next one. Because it doesn't apply to us, or so we think. But even in that, in all of Torah, and I encourage you to start looking at the 613, print out a list, if you haven't done it, of ways that you can be obedient to those 613 laws physically and or spiritually. Now we know Yeshua and the sacrifices, we're not going to be doing bulls and sheep or anything up here. We're not going to do that because Yeshua is our sacrifice. But there are ways to honor him and to be obedient in those spiritually, all of them. If you come up with one that is confusing or you don't understand how that would even be applicable to you, ask Yahweh. Spiritually, you will find amazing, amazing things. As long as you're not acting as the fleshly, carnal person that needs to be saved. Because then you'll see the 613 that you're breaking. But instead, you go back over here and you see all the ways that Yahweh wants you to be obedient. And all the ways that he wants you to honor him. And the ways that when you do that, he goes, good, you got it, good job. And then 5 minutes later, you go back over here, and he's like, well, maybe he gives you a little spiritual in the shin, but he disciplines you. And then that reminds you to go back over here. Have you ever had the kind of arguments with someone where, hey, it's really good, and then you yell something at them, oh, please forgive me, and then you go back over here. But I was justified in doing it because of this, and I had a hard day. But still, it's okay because Yahweh's redeeming me on that. Because it's the same thing that I did last week. But, you know, God delivered me from that as well. Have you ever had conversations like that with people? Where you go back and forth, the same thing, arguments with spouses, conversations with children. Parents, have you ever had those conversations where you go back and forth and back and forth? The point of all this that I'm saying, the point of all of this randomness and walking back and forth is I hope to some degree you guys are confused. Not many preachers or pastors are ever going to say that. But seriously, I want you guys to be confused for a moment. Until you realize that it's in that confusion where you don't know what's going on that Yahweh wants to bring stability to your thinking and to your life. And to help you realize, 1 Peter 2, that you are a kingdom of priests. You are chosen. You are holy. Now, as you read through that, we love those verses, don't we? You're chosen. You're a royal priesthood. You're loved. All these things. But then Yahweh says at the end of it, to offer up spiritual sacrifices. That's the part that we don't like. We like to know, yes, I'm chosen. Yes, I'm holy. Yes, I'm righteous. Yes, I'm set apart. Now Yahweh wants us to do something with it. He wants us to live out our faith. And that is hard because it's easy to think about it perfectly when you're just chosen and he's telling you who you are. Praise be to Yeshua. Through all these things are possible. But then he wants us to do something, and that's where the failure begins. It's also where the success and the obedience to Yahweh and the blessings come in as well. You guys kind of see what's going on here? You guys picking up any of it? Is it just too weird? Is it too random? So I'm about ready to close. And I'm not sure what we do at the end of these studies, but we'll have a quick time of prayer. Is tomorrow you will fail. 7:57 in the morning, you're going to fail. Give or take a few minutes. 9:53, you'll succeed. You'll repent. You'll realize that that's not how you're supposed to be. 1:18, you're going to yell at your spouse. 1:20, you're going to repent. 5 o'clock, you're going to accidentally eat some pepperoni. 2 minutes later, you're going to realize it, you're going to take it off, and you're going to thank Yahweh for being a God who cleanses because you have the living water within you. Then you're going to wake up on Wednesday, and you're going to have a fabulous day. You're going to be in the Word. You're going to start memorizing scriptures. You're going to call one another, and you're going to say, hey, I got this. I learned this. Praise God. You're going to go to work and you're going to share it with a coworker. You're going to call your parents and you're going to say, hey, guess what I learned today? You're going to go and you're going to bless your children. You're going to take your spouse on a date. You're going to give a little bit to the charity of your choice. It's going to be an awesome day. Absolutely awesome. And then Thursday is just going to be a day of misery and failure where you wish that you never even got out of bed. Because you feel like you brought so much damage to the kingdom of God. And Friday, you're going to be soul searching, looking at all the different ways that you can honor Yahweh. And then Friday night, you're going to enter into a Rev Shabbat. And you're going to be reminded that all of this has nothing to do with you. It has to do with praise be to Yeshua HaMashiach, who delivers us from these things. And then the next week, the cycle starts all over again. The thing that we need to remember is that we will go back and forth. We will go back and forth. And the sooner that you understand that, the sooner that you accept it, the sooner you can move on as a priest, as a bride, as a child of Messiah. I want you guys to be content with that. I'm not asking that you be content with the percentage of failure or success. We should always be trying to be refined a little bit more. But do it with the understanding that you have two natures in you, the carnal, fleshly, enslaved to sin person. But you also have the redeemed, saved, cleansed, chosen, holy, righteous, redeemed priest of Yahweh. And praise be to God, through Yeshua HaMashiach, that is the side that wins. That is the side that you are actually enslaved to. You've been freed from the law of sin and death and all those things. And that's a term, that's a phrase I want you guys to start thinking about when you go through Romans and Galatians, because there are two different laws that Paul talks about there. But you are now bound to Yeshua. You are now bound to Yahweh because he has removed the law of sin and death from your life. Amen? Amen? You guys understand that? Yes. Okay, can you guys stand up with me? Do we have someone to close in prayer afterwards, or can I do that? Okay. Father God, thank you so much for being a God who is intimately involved in every aspect of our life. You are a God who cares about every single part of what we do on a daily basis. And Father, you desire that to be a form of ministry to you, a form of worship, a form of honoring you in absolutely everything that we say and do. And Father, at this time, I want us all to remember that as much as we might fail, that is not who you are. And so all the negativity, all the failure and everything that I've mentioned that we've gone through, that is not who you are anymore. I want to remind each and every one of you of that. You will go back and forth. Who cares? Who cares how many times, Father, that we have failed? But Father, let us remember and let us focus on the fact that because of your Spirit that lives within us, because of your merciful and gracious salvation that was given to us, Father, we are seen clean and clear before you. And may that be what we remember. May that be what we focus on, because we want to focus less on us and more on you. And I pray that would be what encourages us individually as a body and as the entire body of Messiah. So, Father, we love you. Let us rest in knowing who you are and who we are. We pray this in Yeshua's name. Amen.